Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for venturing out on a snowy afternoon. We all appreciate it and appreciate your time very much. For those of you I haven't met, my name is Tony Genetis. I'm the director of the Pardee Center, and my function here now is simply to welcome you all here for this event, which we're really very excited about. So thank you for coming. The first thing I want to do is introduce Professor Henrik Selin, who will talk a little bit about the importance of the climate negotiations process, and then introduce the ambassador. Henrik?
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm not the person you should clap for, by the way. So welcome to this very, very exciting event. I hope everyone has a good start to the Year of the Monkey. It's my sort of distinct privilege and honor to welcome and introduce our guest speaker today, Ambassador Laurence Tubiana. Now, there is a number of us here at BU faculty who work on issues of climate change, environment, renewable energy, and sustainable development. And we also have a large number of students, both undergraduate and graduate students, who are very interested in these issues and study them very carefully. So what that means is that there was a lot of us here at BU and in the greater Boston community who very closely followed the preparations for the Paris Climate Summit last year, in December last year, also known as COP21. And many of us are now sort of busy both evaluating and examining the Paris Agreement. So what is the content and structure of the Paris Agreement, and how should we look at its sort of significance in the history of climate change negotiations over the last 25 years? Now, I've heard some colleagues, not here at BU, but outside BU, that argue that the Paris Agreement was such a momentous event that the people behind it should definitely be nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. I've also heard some colleagues being more sort of cautiously optimistic and think that this is it's a very useful start for the future. And then there are others that have expressed more criticism. But I think that irrespective of one's opinion about the Paris Agreement per se, it's clear that the French hosts did an absolutely magnificent job in organizing and carrying out the Paris Climate Change Conference. So after the Danish debacle of 2009, France showed that Europe is in fact capable of carrying out global climate change negotiations and climate diplomacy and lead a meeting to a successful end. And no one, absolutely no one, was more integral in this process than Ambassador Tubiana. So we are really, really honored that she's here with us today. And as you can imagine, she has a very long and impressive resume. But one of the things that really stand out, at least to me, is her ability to work across academia, civil society, and the public sector, that she reaches across multiple venues and sort of embody the person who can speak to multiple audience and work in multiple environments. And it's exactly more of that that we need in the world today. And it also happens to be the kind of engagement that we're also valuing and promoting here at the Pardee School of Global Studies. Among many things, Ambassador Tubiana is a professor at Sciences Po. That's when she's wearing her academic hat, where she's the director of the Sustainable Development Center. She's also the founder of one of the leading policy research organizations in France, the Institute for Sustainable Development and International Relations. She's also served as the advisor to numerous French governments and ministers, and she also serves as a member of several boards and major networks, both in France and globally. So it was really no surprise when in May 2014, she was appointed as the special representative of the French government for the 2015 Climate Change Conference. In many ways, she was the obvious and perfect choice for that role. And in the 18 months that then followed, she worked extremely hard, traveling all over the world, reaching out to all the major stakeholders to trying to lay the ground for a successful conference in Paris and the adoption of a Paris Agreement. Not only that, but more than anyone else, probably, when it came to the actual meeting in Paris, she was there for all the major debates, all the major negotiations, and a behind-the-scenes outlook behind what eventually emerged as the Paris Agreement. So I'm sure that we will all get a fascinating behind-the-scenes account of Paris. And now you can applaud, and please join me in welcoming Ambassador Tubiana to Boston University.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm really thankful of good idea of my friend Adil Najam to told me it was, I don't know, it was December or January to say, why don't you come to explain what happened to you in a way in Paris. And by the way, it's a I think it's the first time I will, in front of a distinguished assembly, try to get my sort of understanding and explain to you how I understand what really happened in Paris. And it's I'm grateful to have this opportunity to just step back and have a look at it from an academic point of view, of course, as a sort of policy wonk, as we say. So thank you to the Pardee School to have invited, and thank you for being there in spite of the difficult weather. And again, don't hesitate after, I suppose I will just try to put out some idea, flesh out some ideas, and would be really very happy of your feedbacks. So what happened to the idea that we were, of course, preparing for having something in Paris, but that the title is telling us at the same time, thinking very, very strongly what happens immediately after. So all the preparation, in a way, was geared to what happened on the 12th of December or the 13th of December after, and not only what happened before, but what more, much more importantly, what will happen after. So we were looking for an agreement both universal, ambitious, and hybrid and flexible. And this is where, for many reasons, we were trying to get that. Because mainly because of the history of these climate talks, starting from 1992 and 1997, Kyoto, and after. And as many specialists of environment governance, we can tell that these processes in environment, and in particular in climate change, are really learning processes of essays and error to try to find the real fit between the problem and the way to handle it at the governance level. And climate change is a good proof of this institutional fit. It's not there. We know that we have to make progress, but what is fascinating is that delegates, government, scientists, whoever, try to improve something which is so complex to handle a very complex and global issues with what we have in hands as an institutional devices. So why universal? It's a little surprising when you see that the last phrase of Copenhagen Accord is that no binding agreement, international binding agreement, would be organized on climate. That was, I said, a very clear element, huh? A sovereignty of states, and the idea that no binding international binding agreement could be the result of this process. It was in 2009, and as soon as 2010, in Cancun, the issue of how we build a global environment binding agreement came back, and that is why we have this process leading to Paris. So it is a constant demand from very different countries, not only developed countries or developing one, but subgroups of countries, that we have to close the Copenhagen story and build a new one because we need this instrument. A universal instrument. Of course, it was evidently a matter of survival for the small islands of the Pacific, because this idea of having only the pledge and review system couldn't work, and at least could not, in a way, ensure that they have a chance of surviving. And additionally, and it was interesting to see this coming progressively in the discussion, in the conversation, that only a universal agreement could provide a signal powerful enough for the private sector in favor of the global low carbon and resilient economy. So it was not only the government that needed this global agreement, and that really the process produces that throughout, starting in Cancun and in particular in Durban, but the private sector as well, that was coming to be an actor in this conversation, wanting the government to be serious and give signals. So that was the main sort of rationale behind this notion of we need a universal agreement and we need it as binding as possible. So the second element was the ambition of it, which in a way was probably, whatever we think of what we achieved in Paris, the most surprising feature of the outcome was certainly the long-term goal and all the elements of increasing ambition over time that are a very main feature of the Paris outcome. And in a way, if the presidency as a host has a target, has an objective, a goal, it was clearly this one. We knew that we had to accommodate with many different interests, but in our view, a presidency strategy should be to get the most ambitious agreement possible. So yes, countries have concern, they have their political economy concerns, we have to deal with these concerns, but the idea to have the lowest denominator was not the target, was not the objective of the presidency. So in a way, we have a vested interest there. We wanted, of course, an agreement, of course, because it was needed, because, of course, French diplomacy wanted this as a success. But we wanted a very specific one, meaning we have an objective. And I must say, it was very clear from the beginning that we were expressing ourselves not only in neutral form, like, of course, we will listen to everybody, and France, of course, is not writing the agreement. It is pushing for a compromise between countries. But we added to that beyond our broker role, honest broker role, we have a very specific view. We wanted the more ambitious agreement possible. So from the start, we were very clear that we will play a role in pushing the ball as far as we could. We knew that from the start that the sum of the INDCs, the intended national determined contribution, that was part of the deal, that it was the pledge part of the agreement, would never get us where we needed to be, consistent with any target in temperature around 2 degrees C or under. And that was very clear, and that was in a way accepted. The recognition among countries was very clear on that path. So we need to have the target, the global goal target, as a direction of travel, even if we knew from the start that the INDCs were only the first essay, the first element, and that they would not be enough. And that so that was a very important element to be recognized. So we had several formulation of the long-term objectives. So we try in different settings to push for this. First in G7, we propose a full decarbonization of the global economy by the end of the century. We try another one, finally we got in the agreement, the carbon neutral global economy, the zero net emissions. And there was another one we try again, just to give the sense of the transformation that was needed if we would like to be compatible with and consistent with a 2 degrees C target, the full transition to renewable energy by the end of the century. All these global goals, we are discussing many places, a September lunch between head of state in New York, think tanks meetings, and NGOs, business dialogue. So this sort of the socialization of what could be the global goal was a very important part of our work. This agreement has to be hybrid and flexible. Hybrid because in a way we knew that the timetables and targets model based on a budget, a carbon budget, was dead. Of course, it died before Copenhagen even. But that we felt and we knew that this notion of the pledge and review only was not enough, was not giving the solution. So that's why the combination of the top-down regime and the bottom-up regime was finally what we were looking for, meaning that we knew that we not have one central coordination mechanism like the burden sharing plus carbon markets. That was a philosophy behind Kyoto in 1997. But we have to find something else. So we have the combination between the INDCs and a common rule. So this part was bottom up. But we have a framework, or we should work for a framework, a unified framework of transparency, meaning a common rule for everyone. And additionally to that, the idea that this common framework of rules, basically on one side on transparency, has to be coupled with a mechanism of review and improvement of this unilateral pledge and review system. So the combination between global pressure and common rules and individual decision making is really at the core of the institution that has been built through the Paris Agreement. And of course, recognizing the inadequacy of Kyoto concept. Beyond that, we need the flexibility dimension because it's a very complex exercise for countries to decide and engage and commit to something is a very long-term perspective on their own development is not easy. And for a country, and many where many developing countries did that. Again, 190 countries now have put forward INDCs, which is overwhelming. We much beyond our expectation. This 190, for the first time in many cases, put forward plans for 2030. And this encompasses a number of uncertainties. What will be the economy, the global economy in 2030? What is the capacity in the countries to make this transformation? How much, what will be the cost of the technology available at that moment and even beyond? So the idea that you have to be flexible because there are uncertainties to be sort of solved and there are changing economic circumstances and technology will change. So you can't have one thing set in stone without this reviewing mechanism. And that, I think, was a powerful argument for the flexibility, but for common rules. So why did we get an agreement in Paris? And then I will try to explain why did we get an agreement that was beyond even our expectation. And I can tell you, I was preparing myself to be disappointed. I was sure we will have an agreement in Paris, but I was prepared to be disappointed. It means that we could not get this all these elements that may give us a chance, but only a chance, to really solve the issue, at least to address it seriously. I think there was a combination of various cycles, political cycles, that finally worked together, and which is, I think, an important element that maybe time is the best organizing principle we can use in this particular setting in for all this climate change is about really a many distributed decision over a country and over, of course, a big amount of countries. And this means that it's quite difficult to have, and we don't have, again, a central mechanism. So the way that time can organize because of the momentum is certainly something to think about. That's why when you look at these cycles, we realize that we were in a particular moment where all these cycles finally worked together. The G2 needed an agreement in 2015 for different domestic reasons. US for, better because Obama wanted to do something serious about that and could not do that if others were not delivering on the same proportion. There was, of course, the preparation of the five-year Chinese plan. Even beyond that, China has decided in between 2007 and 2010 that climate change was then a very serious issue for them, and they can't go alone in climate policy as U.S. can't go alone with climate policy. So diversification of the economy began to be, which is an old sort of a mantra of the Chinese leadership, began to be something linked to us, climate change, the energy mix, etc., and the need to accommodate urban middle class, in particular because of local pollution. So this created a G2 cycle that worked very well. And we can say that starting from 2008, the idea that something has to change in the business economic development model, in the business model of companies, was now more and more sort of there in the conversation. The idea that to combat climate change was an opportunity and not a burden, what we call the solution agenda, was finally getting through. And we have probably somehow the effect of the 2008 crisis, but some pioneers like Mark Carney, the governor of the Bank of England, who is now a good advocate for using sort of taking in account the carbon risk and the climate risk in the evaluation of assets. Bloomberg, as a not only a philanthropist but an investor, telling new energy, clean energy is the future, but we can have many more now. Paul Polman, the CEO of Unilever, saying you have to reform the value chain in the sense of sustainability. At the same time, there was really a social cycle where NGOs, mobilization of the civil society, cities, were, you know, we're constantly talking together, and we talk to them, of course, very, very frequently. And this combined in a way that there was a lot of interest in different circles to have a success in Paris. Even the more critical movement or circles that we were thinking more about what after Paris, we're thinking we need a success, we need a victory in the environmental movement. That was very strong. And I think that, in a way, allow many different visions to coincide. And then we have the diplomatic cycle itself, because you felt that in Cancun, people wanted to rescue multilateralism. It was clear. Cancun was not a big achievement in terms of what we achieve as an agreement. It was like a more short term. It was a first attempt of this new system. But the feeling that you have to restore multilateralism was very much there. And then I think the idea that these negotiators, and certainly there are a personal dimension in it, your people are there from, the Chinese negotiator is there from 1997. He was a young diplomat there at that moment, but you find many. So there is something like a personal achievement to deliver something that is a response to what appears a defining problem, a defining global problem, and not to be able to deliver a solution. So there's something like it was the right moment for people to accept to really change their negotiation method. There was secondly, a political space we created for each constituency to express their needs and requirements. In a way, it was I called that a 360 degrees diplomacy. It was not a diplomacy only to government, by far. I think I spent as much time with NGOs, with business, with investors, than with government. And not only myself, of course, Minister Fabius as a president, the future president of the COP, the President Hollande, the government, there was the ambassadors in the countries. It was always talking to the media, talking to the NGOs, talking to the academia, just to create the political space, listen what the needs were, and to try to in a way, assemble some things that everyone can recognize, could own, and could recognize. And it's fun because when you read the sort of evaluation, you can have a third world network evaluation saying, look, like-minded, you know, the most tougher countries won a victory in Paris. And Paris and the China leadership say it was a very good argument for China, etc. And you see the list of people who says, it's our agreement, we won. It's impressive. And even Greenpeace, you may remember, on the 12th of December, 13th of December, said it's a very good agreement. It's not the end of the story by far. It's just a starting point. But really, this means that we were able to understand what were the key criteria of success for everyone. We sort of, the implication of the political leaders and the different levels of the government was very important because it was an element of disruption in Copenhagen. The ways that leaders interact or not with the ministers, interacting or not with the negotiators, was certainly one of the a weak point of the process itself. So we tried to organize this very, very carefully through the September meeting in New York, with quite strong conclusion of this meeting, then on the first day of the COP, and we were very strict in telling there will be no second day for the head of state and government. So it's a first day only. Of course, you know that 150 came, which was beyond, again, our expectation. But, of course, very linked with the terrorist attacks in Paris. But these leaders gave a statement, gave a push. Even the ones who were not that sort of in favor of a strong climate regime. And then they left. So I think this was a careful management with the ministers that were introduced very early in the process, much earlier than normal. We began informal ministerials as early as July to get them acquainted with all the details. And then some were named facilitators, was all over the political spectrum, and they helped a lot at the end, I must tell you. We had really private sector moment with business weeks, business dialogue. We had city and subnational entities meeting. We have development and climate finance meeting where we have an involvement of finance ministers in Lima in October, together with international financial institutions. We have many informal meetings with negotiator and expert, using at the maximum we could the informal networks of think tanks that were working with the negotiators, really building up exchange of views. And of course, formal and regular dialogues with NGOs, which was a very important part of the job as well. In a way, it was a very clear explanation of what was our strategy. So the idea was to go exactly the other way around, learning from past errors and failures, that it was better to have a very transparent strategy, not to have any hidden card, because in a way that was creating what was the most important element of all the process was the creation of trust. And for those who follow climate negotiations, you know that this trust was a mantra for many, many, many periods of negotiation. The idea that people were not trusting the process was very strong. And at the end, you could listen in Paris, in particular on the last week, everyone speaking about trust. So this was the capital. This was a value to be constructed. And this was obtained through a very sort of a forward-looking sort of strategy telling, this is where we want to go. This is the way we will do. You will have this meeting at this time. There will be these results. And that what we call the no surprise policy. So we have additionally an intense bilateral and diplomatic legwork by the COP21 presidency. And that's interesting for multilateralism in per se, the view that bilateral relation can help a lot the system to improve and to solve problems. So all the bilateral meetings and declaration, and there were many, that's interesting to see, prepared by many, by us, of course, but mostly by US, by China, by India, and others. All these bilateral declaration created a playing field where, in a way, the socialization of what the landing ground could be was the product of all this effort. And so we place that too. Even with a lot of question before running in that direction, going in that direction, because it could have a negative impact, because we could have said, you discuss more with this one than the other one. We were not able to produce 195 common declaration, bilateral declaration. So it was a big choice. We were not so sure finally, but it pays off. And it pays off because many were trying to do the same. Germany tried to do that brilliantly with Brazil. US have done this important bilateral declaration with China. China tried to organize itself with others. So this was finally a support in the multilateral process and not a weakening of the process. And I think that is very important. We try to understand, in particular with countries like China, we try to settle some contentious issue with China before COP, with India, to try to understand what could be a win for India in the process, and we identify the solar alliance and technology. We wanted a win for Africa, and particularly the idea was to try to build the Renewable Energy for Africa initiative that was later picked up by the African Union. So we're looking for wins for the different groups. And for OASIS in particular and the Latin American progressive countries, it was basically one elements on finance, but as well elements on the long-term goal. And of course, others as well. So this was really the preparation, trying to understand the needs and the potential wins for everyone. We did invest a lot of effort with what a classical theorist you certainly study in your classrooms, that Putnam is putting forward as this two-level game, meaning we had to understand the political economy in the main player. You may remember 5 or 6 years ago, everyone in the environment negotiation, in climate in particular, knew about American politics. We knew that by heart. But the other countries, it's like they have no politics. But of course they have, and a lot. And in particular, when you deal with central issues like energy, transport, land use, agriculture, forest. So my obsession, and because of my academic background, we need to understand the politics in each country, and they are different. And we have to identify the progressive actors there and facilitate domestic dialogue when useful. And I must tell the ambassador, French ambassadors, everyone put under pressure by their very strong minister, went to meet the negotiator of each country, organized debates within in the embassy when it was necessary, talk to the civil societies, to the press, to the business, to understand who were the ones that would have an interest in an agreement in Paris. And so that was, I think, an enormous value, because when I met anyone, I knew what were the pros and cons in its own country, what the oil minister of Saudi was discussing with his peers in Riyadh, and what could be, of course, the thing he has to bring back home. And I knew that for the basic players. So, and it was so important to ask the networks that wanted an agreement in Paris to use their capacity at national level and at global level. So the businesses to work on the international networks, as well as the local authorities, to create this campaign of the yes-sayer for the Paris Agreement. We were, of course, looking for allies in the process. And I mentioned that the G2 was, of course, a strong ally, but a dangerous ally, because, of course, you imagine an agreement between US and China can fit well the needs and on the two sides, but may not fit with the others, of course. And it could be as dangerous as the attempt in Copenhagen to find an agreement that fits well with US. And of course, that was basically one reason of failure. But then if you just even stated that the agreement will be finally what the proposal of China and US could be, then you run an enormous risk. And we were absolutely conscious of that risk. It's like you have a big crocodile with the mouth open and you have to go just through and not be captured by him. So it was exactly that. Very important element, because that was building a playing field, but you have to see what more you could put. And that was with whom? So how this grouping, there's a small islands. The EU played a big role. The very innovative role that Latin American countries began to play for interesting reasons we can discuss after. And then the US decided to join the High Ambition Coalition, and then Brazil, which was the first time US just appointed itself in a group that was saying we need a very ambitious agreement. South Africa helped because South Africa maintained the discipline in the G77 group, wanting to have a legacy from the Durban mandate. And of course, we were there as co-presidency helping, which I think is very sort of interesting because we learned very much what happened before and the mistakes. We worked with Peru from the start to see that they have to be with us until the end, because we need to combat the prejudice of being a rich country. So we have to combat the rich country syndrome and to be one aware that we were not misunderstanding where the position were. So we need, of course, a balance of views, and Peru could bring that. And of course, to win the trust. And again, we have a sort of an obstacle being developed countries. And of course, we knew the details, the technical details you have to know, to just to pursue the high-level equilibrium we were working on. Maybe we have to understand, and we can do that in the discussion, that at any moment, it was so difficult for countries to negotiate directly to each other. We are in a world where, on one side, the system sort of tend to be a members-led system, where you don't have a sort of an organization that is preparing the solution. And you have really something where sovereignty is fully respected and is a key factor. But at the same time, this creates a mere impossibility to discuss when you have so many variables in an agreement, which is a case for climate. So the need of the third party is even more evident. So we in a way, I think that's what the lessons we can draw out of Paris. Countries could not negotiate directly, so they had to trust the French presidency to put forward a compromise. And the only way we could accommodate this tension between the need to keep the sovereignty in and to keep to shy away on any delegation of sovereignty was to put forward proposal and compromise, but with still political option clearly open, and let people discuss around this political option, and then to close progressively the options, but with a full transparency of what the process was about. That's what we told. We are not negotiating in a small group. We finally decided not to do so. We will always be the one drafting, but everybody would see that we are drafting and there is no green room syndrome. So I think that was very, very important as a process. And finally, we worked a lot on expectations. That was sort of something that many told me before, many friends and from academia or from government. You have to understand what would be the message on the December 12th. What is it? What do you want? What do you want media to say? And so we began from this. What do we want? We don't want numbers and targets. That will not make it alone. We want the transformation of the economy. So the message we want to have on December 12th is low carbon economy is inevitable, desirable, and is already there. It's just a matter of acceleration. So starting from the end point, we just began to reconstruct what we need to get there. So we need a narrative, a common narrative, but not from government only. We need a common narrative across the board. So we worked on each constituency criteria of success to try to see if we could, explaining again the strategy, they could join in a common evaluation afterwards, even if the evaluation was critical and was not happy with all the results, of course. And then we decided to just announce that Paris was not the end of the story, at the contrary, which is true, it can't. An agreement will not do the transformation of the economy by itself. So it's a turning point, and the idea that we have to write and express and transmit that Paris is a turning point and not the ultimate solution to the road through Paris began to appear in many, many conversations. And we were looking for a self-fulfilling prophecy. In a way, you think, you look at the financial markets where you see that if different actors have the same expectation, the evolution will happen. Well, that's a very, of course, classical example of Robert Merton on the bankruptcy. And we were thinking, if every opinion leaders interpret Paris as a success, there's the best chance for the Paris Agreement to be enforced. So we were looking for this notion that expectation narrative converged, because that will make finally the agreement work. And so that was something we really be very importantly, we insisted on that. So what are the results more quickly? You may have seen that in the press already very much. So the idea is that the strong points that we have to have the progression of nationally determined contribution at each round and hopefully between the rounds before of the global stock takes. We have this long-term objective, which was this big win, not because it's easy. Of course, it's for the moment we don't see how we get there, but it gives a direction of travel, which is a strong transformative travel. We got this global stock take every 5 years, which was a big discussion with, in particular, emerging countries, starting in 2018, because that before the entry into force of the agreement. And we insisted a lot on the pre-2020 package, meaning how we accelerate action before the agreement enter into force, and particularly on finance, on technology, and on this notion, new notion of champions, which mean people who will embodied the necessity of action, acceleration, and mobilization. And we constructed together with other governments big initiative, innovation and technology, what we call mission innovation, was 20 governments and 27 venture capitalists, the Solar Alliance, headed by Modi and France, and the new renewable energy in Africa. And we tried to have a broad involvement of civil society through what we call the solution agenda, the Lima Paris Action Agenda, the Paris Pledge, which is a sign up for the Paris Agreement. And we tried to build this platform where all commitment of non-state actors can be registered. We still, of course, have a long way to see how we create accountability, but at least we have a platform where there's a registry, like for the government. This close association of non-state actors has fostered the convergence of expectation, because they are, of course, opinion leaders, and they can express what they think will happen. And from businesses to cities and influential NGOs, all networks of climate actors contributed to the new narrative, by taking commitments of greenhouse gas emission reduction, announcing targets of investment in renewable energy in particular, letting down portfolio assets linked with fossil fuel-based activities. So this was a way to say, yes, you see, the low carbon economy is just starting now. It's accelerating. So we have we will have meeting points. Again, I told you, I think time will be a very strong organizing principle of this. If we have this meeting point in 2018, in 2023, that's a moment where all pressure will be put on governments to do better. All the businesses will have to make or even follow their commitments, the cities, the mayors, etc. And I think that will really facilitative dialogue. Global stock takes the first one, and the second one would, of course, I think, just maintain the political momentum. That's the dynamic part of it. So what's next? So of course now we have to, that's a time of action. So the problem will be the accountability of all this. How in the real economy the commitments are delivered. Business leaders announce emission reduction, who check, where, how, when. Investors, they have announced decarbonization of their portfolio, how we check, what is really happening. Of course, we have to have governments delivering on their big initiatives they have announced, in particular with a good meeting point of April 22nd, where the agreement will be open to signature on finance, on technology. And then to build, we see that it's a very fascinating moment. We are building the transparency for government action. We have to build the transparency for non-state actors' action. They will certainly not be similar. They may be organized around the same time frame. But I think that's very important now. If we have a governance which has opened effectively to non-state actors, with, of course, formula we have to work on and on, but we need this transparency dimension to be built. So we need a governance for the non-state actors' implication. What the problem probably is the weakest point is that we rely on, because of this member-led type of processes, on the co-presidency. We can be uneven, have different resources, different objectives. That was this notion of high-level champion was finally useful because, in a way, there are person responsible for that. For example, I've been appointed by the French government to be the champion this year. So my concern is to, by November, prove that we have delivered on a number of action. But still, that's a very sort of weak system of accountability. So it would not be enough, certainly. So the three main elements will be the signature and ratification, starting 22nd of April. Preparing the implementation of the INDCs with support, international support, hopefully, immediate action, in particular pre-2020, and I think anything we can learn from this. This has been a certainly very, very interesting experiment of elements and ideas that were around. We didn't invent anything. But it was more than, it is a good moment to learn from all the constructivist approach that have been so much developed in the literature that we need to consider this process as a learning process. We need to change representation. We need to change the perception of national interest. Ideas, science matters. So it was just like to crystallize all these elements, the NGO participation, the idea that we have to have common narratives between government and others. And this happened in Paris. Now, how we learn from this, how we make this really work effectively, of course, that's the question of the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you on all of our behalf, Laurence, for a very, very, very detailed And it you made it sound like it was very simple. For those of us who have been following this, including Copenhagen, it obviously wasn't as simple as you made it sound. And we wanted to have a little conversation on some of that. By the way, I'm Adil Najam. I'm the Dean of the Pardee School of Global Studies, and along with the Pardee Center and Tony Genitos, it is our great pleasure really to have you here. I should note that this is actually the third in a series that really is led by the Pardee Center. There were two events that were done before Paris, one looking at advanced industrialized countries, another panel looking at emerging and developing economies, and this is a great culmination. So it's a great pleasure, Laurence, to have you here. It's my pleasure to have known you for a long while. And I've had the pleasure of seeing you in the last 2 years. I should note, because Laurence knows this already, I've been somewhat of a critic of the process, and sometimes somewhat cynical about what came out. But we'll ask you that about all of that later. But what is clear is that there was something special by the end of Paris. There was a capturing of a hope that even people like me who were sort of deeply skeptical about it, a moment was captured. And that moment was very, very different from the Copenhagen moment. And I thought maybe if you can reflect on what do you think it was about, because it seems to me it was not just what was in the agreement, right? One can take the agreement and okay, dissect it, but there was something. Was it because of what Paris had gone through? Probably not, because it had been captured before. So what was different that made people sort of want Paris to succeed?
Of course, that it's a multiple factors. Some I have raised them already, but and I can just sum up. I think the first thing is, in a world where that's a very global sort of feeling, that in a world where so much violence and uncertainty, the idea that this system can work, that there is something in the international community that has value. So I think that was, in a way, in an issue where, and you know them, we can be skeptical about all these bureaucrats working together, but at the same time, they do that because they believe in something. So there is a purpose there, which I think the sense of purpose was there. And maybe it was stronger than in any time before. Many times, and you know that, Adil, the idea that the purpose of combating climate change was not shared as a common purpose. And I think in Paris it was the first time. Then because of, again, evolution in each country of the thinking, of the science, of the assessment, of the linkages between different elements, that was the first time where for every developing country, the idea that climate change was a sort of fighting climate change was an obstacle to development just began to disappear. So I think in Kyoto and much after and in Copenhagen, there was not the sense that we have a common purpose. So the process was, in a way, was different objectives. And so that, I think, probably the more basic element. Then I think, and of course, you in a way, this is embodied in the change in the position of the major players. When you see China shifting from, I don't want to take any commitment, to, I will accept to peak my emission at a certain date, meaning I don't make any difference now between what developing countries would do and I would do because I think we have the common purpose. And and so I think that was the second big element. And the third element was, we began to see the solution. Again, in Copenhagen, a good example, an anecdote, but it's a good example. You may remember or not that European Union at the end of Copenhagen, in a desperate attempt to save the process, proposed that not having only a sort of pledge of actions, which was finally the result, but to have a sense, what I think we captured in the agreement this time, of a low carbon development strategy, meaning a direction of travel, meaning a direction of the transformation. This was received with enormous skepticism and doubts and méfiance by developing countries, in particular by China. And I remember the Chinese delegate telling me afterwards, we were so surprised by these concepts that we didn't want even to listen about that. And I think 2 months later, the Chinese began to work very seriously on that, meaning they would create the ownership of the discussion. And this means that by Paris, we began to understand and envisage what would be the array of solutions available.
And that became the INDC.
And that became the INDC, and that began the idea that maybe in the future, the economy would look like very different, and it's a benefit. The idea that it is a benefit. It's maybe costly, it will maybe be difficult to get there, but it is a common benefit. So a common purpose, because that was the idea, it's not development against climate change efforts. It could be a common benefit, even if, of course, all distributive effects are there as well. So I think that was, I think, the main rationale behind this. And I don't know, and maybe I think a maturity of the process itself, you know, institutions learn. I do believe that. I know you believe that too. We are not only
some learn slower than others.
Yes, but look, environment institutions are not the slowest one, because they are always under contest, under criticism. Everyone is critics about environment processes. They are ineffective, they are not fit, whatever. When you look at trade, more than 48 years to get there. Look, climate, biodiversity, it's just, the time span is much shorter. So, in a way, I think this process is learning. And I think the proof that now there is a global acceptance that you discuss about reality. It was not the case before.
Can I jump? I know, Tony, I'll be very, but just because you sort of, this question I was really dying to ask. So 10th of December, which was supposed to be the last date, I guess, right? Marked exactly 25 years to the day that the UNFCCC process was created. So for skeptics like me, 25 years was a quarter century, too long. And you are saying, if I hear you right, that it's not that long.
No, look.
So when we talk to our students, these young people, and tell them that we've spent a whole lifetime doing this, and this is what came out, what do you say to them to give them hope that no, 25 years is not that long?
Look, sorry, we are, even in domestic political process, time to transform things is long. But when I look just at the international scene, 1948, the first GATT agreement, for something to negotiate, what is not that complicated. It's not like changing your energy policy, your land use, your forest, whatever. It's just about lowering the trade barriers. And you need more than 45 years to get with the WTO, with more or less rules that really have lowered, of course, the trade barriers, and will slowly begin to deal with domestic policies. More than 45 years. This is about strictly domestic policies. There is very, very little international in climate, frankly. And yes, 25 years is a short time span. So that's my view.
So it is an interesting argument, since all of our undergraduates have never known a world where we were not negotiating climate policy. They were born into a world where we were negotiating, where we'd already been negotiating climate policy for 5 or 6 years. They've lived in that world entirely. And so there is a sense, I think, that the sense of urgency that a lot of people feel. One thing that really struck me about the process that you described, though, was the importance of building trust amongst all the actors, and the enormous effort that entailed, and understandably so. But it does strike me that one of the linchpins of the sort of pledge and monitor process is that first stock taking is enormously important, because trust is hard to acquire and easy to squander. And if that first stock taking is then perceived as countries are not living up to their INDCs and the real economy is not delivering the goods, that then creates a serious problem for moving forward. How do we begin to address that in terms of trusting, but actually then verifying that countries are doing what they say they will do?
I could not agree more with you. Everything will be, that's why we can't see Paris as an end point. It's important because it gives, on one side, it has given disciplines to countries, and it has, in a way, brought together a number of actors that we will implement under the stewardship of government or not, what finally will be the evolution of the society and the economy. So yes, the truth will be there or not. And that's why I think, of course, the more important job to be done now is really to not only to verify and to create these institutions that are important of transparency, because that's the maintenance of the trust, but as well to keep the mobilization. Why finally businesses have gone, some business leaders have gone in this direction? Why Larry Fink, I think 3 or 4 days ago, wrote this letter to the 500 CEOs saying, look guys, after the Paris Agreement, you can't say that you have to not to think long term. Why is this happening? It's probably we need a lot of analysis to understand that. Why expectations are converging, like the CEO of Bank of America told me, that was part of my dialogues. Look, we should not find all elements to justify that we have to do this clean energy because it's cheaper or whatever, or it's a good business opportunity. We should decide that we have to fix it. And it's not, it's a bank. It's a private bank in US.
Why do you think it's happening?
I think it happens because, in a way, there is now the recognition that the moment, and if there is enough people doing it, it will happen, and that will be the new normal. We are seeing the constitution of the new normal under our eyes. We are seeing the emergence of a new concept or new, what is a new norm? That's when a norm is, you know, you never know when it is there, but you see it, it's a sum of many, many decisions, ideas, conversation, and then at one moment it begins to be the new norm. We are seeing that. And I think, you know, it's like a wave, huh? It's smaller at the beginning and then it begins very big and then you don't resist, you just follow. Are we at that particular moment or before or beyond? But I think we are seeing the new norms, and the new norms is even financial norms.
So one of the interesting features of that is that for a decade, 15 years, part of the development of that new normal has been exactly one of the elements that was taken off the table, and this notion of budgets and of targets and budgets.
Or of penalties and regulation,
right?
In the old sense.
And I think, you know, perhaps correctly so in terms of arriving at a successful agreement. But as part of this agreement, we talked a little bit about this at lunchtime, was this fascinating notion that emerged of, well, let's have a 1.5 degree C ambition. At the same time as there is this general acknowledgement that if everybody does the INDCs, it's not ambitious enough to put us on the original 2 degree target. So how does the emergence of that heightened ambition begin to affect the process as it moves forward?
I think that story about 1.5 is very interesting, and just I wanted just to complete on this new normality. Because I, in a way, the elegant scientific solution was carbon budget, sharing, allocation, and markets. That was very elegant. Kyoto was super elegant. The problem, of course, everybody just opt out. Well, most opt out. So elegance is just like didn't work. And so... I think it was much more, we were very much more in a realistic process that can't deliver the same, but so, but what is interesting is that where the norms we are seeing emerging now, in particular on finance, which I think is a key, there are two sort of signals very strong. One is this signal on finance. If finally, these financial stability boards make these recommendations that are now on the table and including will be discussed again in G20. And because, again, what I haven't mentioned, that we consider the climate regime as a regime complex, not only the agreement. We were trying to influence every bit, the IFIs, like the G20, like the G7, etc. So that's something important. And that's why this can converge. If not, you can't do that. And you, in this aspect, you were totally, and you're still totally right. I did. You can't change with the agreement itself. It's impossible, in my view. So you have to align the signals. Mm-hmm. And I see this happening. And again, I think we should, as analysts, analysts and students and scholars look at the signals. Where are they? How is the shape? Who is behind them? And to see if there is a change or not. Again, it will not be just a decision of a government by far. That said, on the 1.5, why is this happening? Why it was accepted? And I remember very well the discussion was the two elements on the temperature and on the zero net emission, which is, we know, we don't know how to get there. That's for sure. But this is about what the science are telling us. The science is not able to deliver a regime. The science has said, this: if you would like to survive in this planet, you better be around this. But then, guys, you have to do the job. So that is the direction. And it was very important for, because there was this controversies even in the scientific communities at 2 degrees, and it's sort of probability depending on the concentration, that finally was too high because of the impacts of a number of territories. So the 1.5 is not useful because it is easy to attain or to limit. It's because it gives the size of the transformation we need. And we need that. Why? Kyoto was very much about incremental. I remember the discussion. I was just beginning on the negotiation in 1997. And it was very much how you begin to curb the emissions. It was not how you decarbonize fully the electricity mm-hmm. production. It was not that. We didn't have that discussion in Kyoto. We did have how we began, we have this carbon budget, how we curb this, and how the market would allocate more efficiently. And now in Paris, and before, of course, all these years, we are talking about how we have an electricity that is totally zero carbon by 2050 in most countries. So again, it's not easy, but we now have concrete goals.
But when we failed even to take those small steps of Kyoto, why are you, and not just you, the world, I'm the minority, why is the world so optimistic that without any mechanism for making people do these things, they will in fact do it this time, when even when it was binding, the country said, no, we wouldn't. But because the world is hopeful. You're not...
Yes, the world is also...
Where does that hope come from? Not history.
But Kyoto was probably a false expectation that this mechanism has teeth. Maybe the teeth were not real. That's true. They were not real teeth. So again, it was about maybe a thinking of what the future could be. And again, the reliance on the market mechanism was the only enforcement mechanism that was really thought through. And okay, it didn't work for many reasons. But so I think now is because, again, I think the theory of rational expectation can help us a lot more than anything to understand why, again, what a norm. When you stop smoking because that's a new norm, you have to just look back at why this happened, even if still.
We have some great people sitting in the audience and we'd want to come to them, but if I can change topics slightly before we do that so that we can also... Laurence and I have been on this World Economic Forum panel together that she chairs and I'm a member of the last 2 years, so I've seen you working, even in meetings when you weren't there because you were everywhere in the world, right? And so it's been a very hectic process, and I think I can honestly say, at least from my point of view, the one person without whom certainly the process would not have been the process that it was, is you. Now, you took on this job when?
I started in May 2014.
You're really sort of the shepherd of the process. And you started in?
May 2014.
What were you thinking? because at that point, Copenhagen has happened, mm-hmm. right? The word Copenhagen, this whole city, this great city has now become a word that is synonymous with things not happening, right? And how does someone take the call or meeting and say, I'm going to do this, when all the odds are that this is not going to be much different? Well, at least at that point.
I was a little frightened, I must say. I was frightened. But, it helps to be an academic. Because in life, when you see such a big problem, if you don't have theory behind, you're just lost. So I use not one, because one concept that lose a number. Basically, I use three ones. The first one, what it is, it is a regime complex. So I can't work on only one point. I have to work on many points. I can't coordinate from top down all these institutions. But I can align objectives. So that was the first one. The second element, so that was there was there behind then a strategy to do so. So how you ask World Bank to announce the amount of funding for climate finance. But so put your objective. I will not decide for you how you do that, but put your objective forward and then work on that. The second element was we have to work basically on the domestic policy, on the political economy of each of the major ones, and to know by heart who is who, because the two-level game matters definitely. And the third concept was this idea, we have to work on the expectations. And in a way, people behave and make things happen depending on what they believe what will happen. And so that is more important as an enforcement mechanism than the sanction, which will not exist and which were not existing in Kyoto, really, and we see that. So that was helping me to shape the strategy. And we had, by July, I had the strategy. I can show you the paper. It's funny.
July of
2014, and then just go. It worked because, it worked, as I said, because everybody wanted an agreement. But the orchestration, of course, was the delicate part. But again, you need concepts to do that.
So 2014, you have a strategy. When was the first time you kind of said to yourself, we'll get an agreement? Because when we were talking October, November, everyone kind of thought, you know, mm-hmm. some thought it would be a good agreement or a bad agreement. But when did you or your team say, I'm going to get an agreement?
I think by, it was beginning of 2015, like after the first, Lima, it was not so clear because Lima was quite active.
Was it the walk in New York? No.
It was, I think even earlier, but yes, September it was clear, but probably like.
But was there a reason, a moment, a meeting? Something happened and you said, okay, now I think we'll get it.
I think the more important moment was this informal meeting, in particular the July one we had with the ministers, and we had a normal conversation. It was a normal conversation between normal people trying to solve a problem and finally understanding what they could agree on.
A normal conversation amongst ministers. Hold that thought and let us see if we have any questions. I'm sure we have a lot. We have someone with a mic.
Thank you so much for your work.
Professor Klinger.
Thank you so much for your
introduce
work.
Introduce yourself for others, please.
I'm Professor Julie Klinger, Professor of International Relations in the Pardee School of Global Studies. And I just want to say thank you so much for your work on this. And I'm really curious if you could describe a process through which you brought someone to the table who didn't want to come.
Can we take a couple and come back? We'll take one more, maybe.
I have not a paper, but I try to remember all. So the obstructionists, how you get them on board.
Maybe
yes.
Up here.
Hi, I'm David Cash. I'm the dean of the McCormick School of Policy and Global Studies at UMass Boston. And
thank you for braving the snow.
it wasn't as bad as they predicted.
Yes.
They've got climate prediction right, but weather not so much. First of all, those of us who are students of negotiation, teachers of negotiation, who've participated in these kinds of things, it's a remarkable story that you're telling, and thank you so much for the detail and the thoughtfulness and the outline of the orchestration and the strategy and the tactics. And you ended on a very compelling and intriguing note, which was, we need to learn from this. So I'm wondering if you have thoughts about how that could happen. You're in a room full of educators, and I would love to hear how you think we should be taking this lesson and using this lesson because it seems like such a great story to tell and such a great curriculum could be built out of this.
Thank you.
We'll take one more right there.
Hi, I'm Anna. I'm a student at Boston University studying environmental analysis and policy. Thank you so much for being here. I was just wondering if you believe that consumerism and culture play a role in the success of these negotiations, especially in developed countries, and if so, what is that role? Thank you.
Thank you for all these questions. And again, we are just trying to think back. So your questions are so precious, really. This trying to respond, which I still have not really responded to you, Adil, why the hope? I think that's sort of something we have to really work on. We brought a particular obstructionist country. I can take the example of the Saudi Arabia, which I think, I would not say that publicly, still I am an ambassador, so. I never comment on countries in particular, but here in this setting is different, it's an analytical issue. I think this is referring to the political economy of each country and understanding the concern and constraints. Arabia Saudi, the Saudis, the negotiators, has two problems. One is very difficult for them because they just begin to say that they were not combating the climate convention, but they would think that they have to work worse, which was a big shift from the traditional position. For we can analyze a number of reasons. So I think partly the willingness not to be isolated, because they, of course, they perceive their dependency for a number of issues as well to others. The second is the diversification of the economy. But I think we understood that they need something that was in a way contested to them from 1992, which was a recognition that the climate policies will affect them, what we call in our jargon the response measures. And of course, initially, this demand on the Saudis was, of course, perceived like totally illegitimate because of the amount of the rent that the country perceived out of the oil market. The idea is that you should compensate them because they are losing money because people don't want to buy oil was, of course, the wrong way this discussion went before. So they had a position that they can never make acceptable to others, and they went every time with this demand, and they were every time rejected. This time, we reframed the question of these response measures, telling it's a problem. Yes, you will have cost on you because that will have an impact, but you could think about the international community could recognize that you have to make an effort of economic diversification. And so it was rather symbolic in a way. So the Saudi negotiators, the Minister of Oil, which I went to see, especially in Istanbul to see him one-to-one, to understand what he has to bring back home in a country where you can't speak about emission reduction. And is this impossible to listen to in this country? So he told me that, so we worked and we tried to frame and to discuss what could be the way he could have these response measures, but he presented in a way that was understandable for everyone, the others, not the oil exporting countries. And so that was, but we had that, of course, in our hands as the negotiating tool. But it was a sincere recognition of their concerns. And so we brought this until the end, and at the end, I negotiated with, 6 in the morning or 7 in the morning, the idea that they will accept the long-term goal, which was for Saudi Arabia, it's a very big thing, against that we recognize that in this context, they will have to diversify their economy and maybe have the capacity to discuss long-term perspective, long-term strategies together with the international community. They were in. the community transforming themselves as well. And it was very interesting to see, because you could recognize two elements, that their adaptation policy could be counted partly as emission reduction because they were using less energy, which was a way to adapt to their politics, like we did for US many times, like we did for Brazil. Brazil was really the forest issue and agriculture was key. So you have to frame the issues in a way that you could use a two-level game. And and that's how we brought this country. So you can't force countries, huh? There is no way. So you have to make the argument that they can bring home something, that they are winning from some elements. And that's why Malaysia, Iran, Bolivia get back to their country saying, we want something. And there was something carved out specifically for each of them.
On the other questions, especially the consumption one, but also the lessons?
On the lessons, I think we should again question, ask, and try to elaborate what is a case study.
Can I rephrase this question also to say, would you do anything differently that you did in this process if you were doing it again tomorrow? Because that's a way of...
I think, to be honest, of course, it's a strategy in a specific historical context. It doesn't have any sense in general. But so with this precaution, I think what I would do differently is probably but that need a sort of a transformation in the institution, to have more clearly a system where you create more accountability to the non-state actors. I think that would make the difference, because it creates a lot of positive interaction with the governments. But again, it's because that's a period. 5 or 10 years ago, government would have been reluctant in listening to even their businesses or their mayors, city mayors. Now is the moment where you can install this conversation. And then if I could do that differently, I would have been much better in organizing this. It was there, these business were there, the city mayors were there, but it was more like music, like a sort of noise, not something designed to a specific target. And culture, yes, it plays, in my view, in developed countries, consumers are now, you feel it, huh? You feel on food products, that's quite evident. It's quite difficult to, it will be more difficult for companies to sell products that doesn't respond in a way to the demands about environment and climate change in particular. So that, I think it's a very huge leverage. That's why business guys like Paul Mann, the Unilever guy, is trying to find a solution for his palm oil, because there is a big rejection in developed countries' consumer side. So he has to find a way where, or he abandoned that product, or he find a way to prove that he's okay with the forest. So I think that's just because of consumer action. He's very nice guys and forward-looking, but he responds to the markets. Where I think that the culture plays enormous role, but it's difficult at the same time, is that we have a different representation among culture of the relation between man and nature. And that was a challenge in the discussion. you see, for countries like some Latin American countries, in particular where indigenous people are very strong, a strong component of the population and the national sentiment, they wanted to have a certain reference to the relation with man and nature, which was so antagonic with what our traditional Western view is, which is much more rationalistic, and we don't have this symbiose between man and nature. And we have a very strong argument until, in a way, we solve this in the agreement in Paris, just to accommodate for that. And I think this intercultural discussion on the relation between man and nature is very, very important to get the international community working more effectively together. And that's what how you saw the indigenous people contribution, and it's not only in climate, in biodiversity is as strong or even stronger. But you feel that if we understand this cultural dialogue, if we establish that, we could do much better.
We have a conflict, of course, and deep in many cultural traditions of this conflict between humans' relationship with nature as dominion as opposed to shepherding.
Yeah.
And so depending on sometimes which minister you go to, you'll get a different
the minister of dominion versus the minister of shepherding.
You get a different interpretation of that.
But dominion are a little losing ground because they are not that good in dominion.
They're not doing that. Yeah, they're not doing that well. I wonder if just before we take another question, you would talk a little bit about some of the other elements of the agreement. We've talked so much about the INDCs, and rightfully so, but we've committed ourselves to a world that will have climate impacts essentially forever. And so this question of adaptation and coping becomes all the more important, because that's now, and has been for some time, an inevitable part of our present and our future. What were the discussions like around this topic of adaptation? And really, so how did the ministers and the negotiators start to treat this topic?
Especially for those countries for whom even 1.5 is too much, actually.
We have impacts now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
It's interesting this because effectively it took time for different component of these governments or even broader with the societies to understand what does it means to mitigate. So look, Kyoto is really for specialists. You see numbers on the carbon budget, nobody understand what is it really. Now when you begin to just learn and go on and understand that it is about public transport versus private cars or whatever, you begin to translate these numbers in something that you can understand, a reality. So that was a process from Kyoto, I think, until now. On adaptation, it's still this work of understanding and learning, I think it's far from being done. One, because there was maybe less solid and detailed science on local impacts, which is true, it's difficult. It's now recent that we have a better understanding with the disaggregation of the climate modeling and local data that we can begin to understand the local impacts. And then you translate that with what happened in health, in agriculture, in water management, whatever. And I think you feel that in adaptation, it was sort of a concept equivalent to responsibility or liability to the ones who have produced the climate change, but not something real, and which already has happened for mitigation, but still is out there, not really precise and grounded like for mitigation. And I think we are there. So the progress was made in really putting enormous political importance on adaptation, trying to mirror what could be done in mitigation in discussing this notion of the global goal of adaptation, which doesn't mean a lot really, but meaning we have to work on that. Mm-hmm. And I think now we are there. So the space of discussion is set for at many levels, targets, probably we will go for targets for finance and adaptation. There are now processes of technical experts to look at what does adaptation means in specific ecosystems. Try to now to build the technological solution. We are talking about now what could be the private funding of adaptation, what share should be only public because of different, of course, of the nature of the problem, etc. So we are late, huh? We are late. I do think that the second group of IPCC will, of course, play a key role again to try to inform more. what is the impact at local level. We don't have that many solutions. We have some solutions, not that many. So an intensive scientific work has to be sort of mobilized by this. And so it's really because it was kept as a political tool, but not at the reality of the problem you have to face. And now I think we shift from from this bargaining chip to something which is, well, we have to cope how we do that.
Let's take another round of question. I'll mark, though, this shadow of loss and damage, which might be with us. We have a microphone there.
Yeah, we have several over here.
Should I introduce myself?
Please.
My name is Rebecca. I'm a graduate student here at the Pardee School of Global Studies. I'm doing international relations and environmental policy. I was wondering, as the global economy has become more integrated and certain sectors have become more international by nature, how has this shaped negotiations since Kyoto? I know that in Kyoto, certain sectors were mentioned in the protocol itself, specifically shipping and aviation, and in Paris, they're not. So I would have thought that with increased integration, it would have been the other way around. So if you could elaborate a little more on that, that would be great.
We'll again take a few. We'll take one there and then here.
Hi, my name is Matthias. I'm a student at BU. First of all, thank you for coming. And as a Frenchman, you did a fantastic job, a lot of excellent work. My question is actually about one of the consequences of the 13th of November attacks, which was the suspension of the mass protest movement. That was supposed to descend upon Paris. We're talking about hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people from all over Europe who were supposed to demonstrate and attest to their support for the negotiations. And you were just talking about one of your regrets being the non-accountability and the non-transparency on the non-state actor side. Do you think a quote-unquote market movement like that would have actually served to put more pressure on institutions to respond to the requirements of the situation?
Thank you. We'll take one more lady here.
I'm Noni Valentine, and I do psychological consulting for international expatriates in Cambridge. And I'm recently back from Prague from a couple of decades, and climate change was kind of laughable in the milieu that I was in. So I am curious about your experience of Eastern Europe, or with Eastern Europe this time around, and any ways that you found your strategies needing to be different than in some other parts of Europe.
Thank you. First, on your reflection on the globalization, I do think that it can play off both ways. But I think in this case now, because of what I tried to explain, that in my view, we are shifting from a norm that disregards the impact of human action to climate change to something that really takes them in account. Then globalization will play a positive role, because there is a difficulty in diverging a lot in technology, for example, or even in policies. And I'm sure you when you study and in your class, you see how you have this movement of converging policy scheme. It's difficult in the global economy of today to have a government that takes a totally different stand. And there are divergences, but the power pool of harmonization is quite strong. So this, I think, can play a positive role. And I think that even in this economic instrument like carbon markets or carbon tax, that many countries are reluctant of having a global carbon market or global carbon tax, of course, by far, but because they want their sovereignty, and that would then come to aviation, because that's exactly the same problem. But they would use finally, and they would go in this direction that seems to be the new normal. So that's one. Nevertheless, the tension is how, in particular because there are states and government negotiating, how they control some things that they are controlling less and less. And there is this tension about the willingness to defend sovereignty and the reality of the sovereignty on the ground, because you can't control that much. You don't control that much financial flows. You even now control with difficulty migration, which was finally the only thing people, states were supposed to be able to control their physical territory. You don't control really effectively information. So you have this tension where at the moment to negotiate, government would really consider seriously how they can retain most of the sovereignty they can, even if it's formal. And that's what aviation, or all what is global, is was a very strong discussion in Paris, by the way. Until the last moment, we have two paragraphs. One mentioning that we have to do such and such for aviation and maritime transport. But each time we were put this paragraph, some developing countries wanted a paragraph saying it can't have any impact on trade. So there was sort of a problem you couldn't solve. So I didn't want to have any reference that you can't have any element that can impact on trade or trade instrument related, because that we may need these ones at one day. So I didn't want that. But it was a price to pay, was no reference to aviation and maritime. So I think that the other limit. We see that it's the same discussion that on the global carbon price. Many businesses or some economists were disappointed because we didn't have a proper discussion on global carbon price. I can enter in a whole discussion on that point, which in a way I didn't find it was an effective discussion anyway and could have had enormous distributional impact, etc. So I didn't even agree with this idea at that stage. But nevertheless, you couldn't have that discussion, not because countries doesn't want to use price carbon. They will. Some will do. China will install its carbon market next year. India is using a proxy for carbon tax or carbon market already. But they can't accept the idea that you would have a global one. Because of what? We are in Boston, no? Boston Tea Party. No taxation without representation. So this is the tension, the limits we feel. So for aviation, we will begin the discussion we have now on standards. I think it's interesting to have pressure on aviation companies to take commitments because of this sort of difficulty. And for developing countries, that the moment where you deal with aviation and maritime, you are preventing them to export. That their view. So we have to take things differently.
The Paris attack.
I think it plays a role in protests. The Paris attack played a role in the convening power for the first day of the 150 head of states and government. Without the Paris attack, I don't think they will have 150 head of state and government coming.
Which makes it the largest gathering of heads of states at one time, ever.
Some say it's compared to 1940 something, but I haven't checked. But if not, on one issue in particular, that's the first time, so it's unprecedented. I think that's largely because some like 1 month before the Paris attack, we were waiting, which was already an enormous number. We didn't invite them strongly, and we'd say, you can come if you want, but it's only for one day. And we have already 90 wanting to come and to speak. So, but this enormous amount, I think, was given to that. Of course, the downside of it was a security problem. And I was hoping myself to have massive march. I was counting on them, like it happened in New York. But I think for the first day in US in 1997, it was 12 million people just marching in here in this country. So anyway, for the 400,000 in New York, still we are far away from what the environmental movement was so many years ago. But I think it's, I was hoping for this. And of course we had, imagine, a long discussion with all sectors of the government to decide what to do. And it was a painful decision not to have them. So the way we offered the two elements, what the most access we could offer on the space where the NGOs could come, or whoever could come, by the way, what we call the Espace Génération Climat, so there was no need to be accredited, you could enter, whatever, and I think almost 90,000 people came in this place. But it was protected, meaning you have to enter through security and we could check if you have arms, etc. But in the street, it was really almost impossible. And it was really a pity, because I think genuinely the spirit of the march were really powerful and helpful. So that's why.
It was about Eastern Europe?
And on Eastern Europe, so it's complicated as a problem, because for a number of countries in Europe, even if Europe is playing again a very strong role, I think so, and is with all its problem, internal problems, is going forward and is the one that shows a direction that you can go for renewable energy, you can go for new solutions. Of course, Eastern Europe is still in the making on how we can get rid of coal, how we can really think that climate is not against our development. And so, in a way, it's good they are inside, because in a way that creates a pressure on them, whatever the governments are thinking. And I think it's good because we can deal with their concerns too, because Poland has concern about energy efficiency, about the coal production. But I see good moves there. We see that some are now saying they will not build new coal-based power plants these days. But it is really a moment where, for the moment, the climate policy appears for some government as an illegitimate pressure from the European consensus on them. And I think we should try to change this narrative. But it depends very much on the intellectuals, the scientists, the businessmen inside, and the NGOs inside the countries.
On that sort of note, as we start move towards wrapping up, but was there a scary moment? What was the moment that was scariest when any time in the process, especially during the COP, was there a moment when you thought, okay, there's a danger that something might go wrong?
There were several moments. The very, very, very delicate moment was we received from the co-chair of the technical process a text that was just...
Last day. Like shall versus should.
No, that at the end. Not that. The first moment was at the end of the first week, the co-chair delivered a text where you have still 1,450 brackets. And it was not in a good shape.
Brackets, for those who don't follow this, is someone has inserted language they want in the agreement, but it's in bracket, which means it hasn't been agreed. So there are lots of people putting lots of language.
Yeah. Right? So we had just many, many, many options on everything. So that we had in the Saturday of the first week. And then we have to jump from this to a negotiable text. So the first scary thing was to say, and as I said, it's a no surprise policy. We will not invent a text. It will be based on the text you produced until that moment. And then we have to make something different, because this could not be the base of the agreement, because of course you have option everywhere on every detail. So that was the first big thing. When we put forward, we'd say, we announced that we will put a new text based on this one, on the first day. That was the first difficult moment. And it went okay. And then we proposed a second draft. It was still okay. We were closing many, many, many brackets. So the first one, we closed almost 90% of the brackets. So that was a big shock. And so we didn't know if countries will accept that.
Again, for those who don't follow it, once you close brackets, you're coming nearer and nearer to consensus.
So you try to choose options. So there was, for example, 5 options on something. So we tried to make choices. We made choices on some elements. And of course, we left open the main political issues. So that the choice where were the main political issues and what we could decide that was closed was on our responsibility, and it was the first scary thing we did. And then we have a second sort of draft based on the same one, with hearing people, accepting comments, but not in, we, people were sending comments, or, but we were only drafting ourselves, so there was no drafting committee. We were just the French presidency doing it, in full transparency, but doing it. And then the scary moment came at the last time, because I think the worst, of course, there was a shell in the shoulder, we'll come back to that, but I think the worst moment was in the early morning on the Saturday, when we made the choice on the long-term goal. We made the choice on finance. We made the choice on the different elements of mitigation, the review, the idea that developing countries should, over time, go to absolute emission reduction, strategy, so all the elements. And then we didn't negotiate that. On the previous day, the previous 2 days, people were not happy with this notion of 1.5 or a long-term goal. And so we decided that we took the risk. But of course, so the worst moment was when we began just to test just before printing. No, it was already in print. And we just began to explain to the different groups what was in the text they haven't seen and what they would like and that they would dislike deeply. And that was it. We could not propose a better compromise. And though that was very, very scary. The morning where I discussed a long-term goal with the Saudis and with what we call the like-minded group, which is a group of the more difficult countries, China, India, Venezuela, Bolivia, Saudi Arabia, Emirates, etc., Algeria and others, Malaysia, which was sort of the leaders of the group. And it was really a very scary moment. When I just began, it was again, I haven't slept almost 3 days. And I went and explained to them what was in the text without, of course, allowing them to read, because we wanted everybody to have the text at the same time and no leakage. And that was a very scary moment. And the last scary moment, so I was not sure. And at one point in time, the Chinese began to be very reluctant to the long-term goal and then decided to say yes. But we didn't know, really. And finally, it was this element where we were really exhausted. And between the second draft and the third draft, for internal reason, because we didn't want any leakage to the text. So we were working on 7 computers, different computers, not to have leakage. And so, of course, at the end, we have to regroup everything in one file and then to revise it.
So there are 7 computers so that nothing leaks. In you are the only one who knows which computer has the real one, or do they all have real one?
It was a very, very small group, but very, very, very tiny group of people who knows where files, at least on the last night, where the files. And then we began of combining them, in a very small room with, of course, ourselves.
Intelligence studies colleagues here wondering, this is a climate negotiation, 7 computers. Sorry, go ahead.
And then we began to combine everything. And meanwhile, there was, of course, still people negotiating in some more specific issues. As I told you, nobody negotiated the whole package. So we just proposed compromise. but there was some specific points that were negotiated between US and, let's say, houses on loss and damages, for example, or forest, or some market mechanism was also. So this was in parallel, and then we were combining the different solutions. And then, I don't know, it happens on a mistake of when we revise all the text, and this one draft, which was very important, saying this all countries in a way have to move toward economy-wide absolute emission reduction, which is a very important political point for developing countries, but that developed countries should do the same, should continue to do so, and then was changed to shall continue to do so, which is a Kyoto formula. And of course, the US could not accept the Kyoto formula because they are not in, so they can't say shall continue as an obligation whether they didn't sign up Kyoto. And we didn't realize that this was changed until 3 p.m, because we were just exhausted when we realized.
Again, for those who didn't follow the drama like some of us did, so negotiations were supposed to end, you have an added final day, everyone is in the room waiting for you to come and open the champagne, and you don't come, and you don't come for half an hour, right? And the shall, tell me if I'm wrong or right, shall and should, just for everyone, if it says a country shall do this, that can be construed as a requirement.
A legal obligation.
A legal obligation. If it says a country should do this, it's advice.
It's a choice of the government, right, to do so. It cannot translate in a legal liability. You can't attack anybody not to have done that.
And speaking of politics, is it true that a shall could have been construed as the U.S. requiring to take that document to Congress?
That were what they said. And we have been internalizing that constraint before. Even, I must say, this formulation that developed countries should continue and developing countries shall was inserted in the bilateral declaration we draft together with China, between France and China, because that was a point we wanted to have in the agreement. We wanted two things out of them. We wanted this, that every developing country would over time go to absolute emission reduction, and that we wanted the revision clause every 5 years. So we of course, when we crafted that, we crafted bearing in mind the constraint of US. And China was, of course, okay with that. And that slept, that was a mistake at the end by the ones who just assembled the text at the end, which was the people in the secretariat of UNFCCC. So you never know. But for US, it was a major, major blow. So, and we didn't intend it to that because we knew exactly what we have written and why it was so. So that was the last, of course, element. And the sort of the surprise at the end. And it went well, finally. And it was interesting the way we just say it is a mistake. And we can in a way, you have trusted us. It was in our previous draft, drafted with a should. You should trust us, it's a mistake. We didn't want to put that such. And it worked.
So in the sense that all's well that ends well, I'm going to suggest that that we move from here to the reception area. So if you'll join me in thanking the ambassador for
Thank you very much.